You can't ride two horses. Speech at a public meeting at Lucknow, January 6, 1948. Our achievements of the last 4 months have to some extent resorted the country's prestige. It restored, it brought back, which it had lost in the eyes of the world because of the unfortunate happenings following partition. I appeal to the younger generation to assist us in consolidating and making her impregnable. The maintenance of communal and industrial peace is essential if the newly born independent democratic state of India is to lead the Asian countries on the road to progress and emancipation from foreign domination. I'm a true friend of the Muslims, although I've been described as their greatest enemy. I believe in plain speaking. I do not know how to mince matters. I want to tell them frankly that mere declaration of loyalty to the Indian Union will not help them at this critical juncture. They must give practical proof of their declarations. I ask them why they do not unequivocally denounce Pakistan for attacking Indian territory with the connivance of the frontier tribesmen. Is it not their duty to condemn all acts of aggression against India? I invite the RSS to join Congress and not to weaken the administration by creating unrest in the country. I realize that they are not actuated by selfish motives. Yes, I do so. But the situation warrants that they should strengthen the hands of the government and assist in maintaining peace. By using violence, they cannot render true service to the country. The ever-changing, indecisive and non-committed attitude of Pakistan must be changed. Pakistan should change policy in her own interest. The Junagadh and Kashmir incidents have demonstrated her intentions. If you want to divide the rest of India also, say it boldly. And let us decide the issue openly. The Pakistan leaders have accused the Congress of sabotaging Pakistan. That is far from the truth. The establishment of Pakistan has been advocated as a haven for Muslims. We should be glad if they make it a real heaven. They must realize that the enemies of Pakistan are inside it and not outside. If Pakistan collapses, she will collapse by her own mistakes, by her own sins. Today I think of those days when in the city of Lucknow, the foundation of the two-nation theory was laid. It was said Muslim culture and tradition were not akin to those of the Hindus. Muslims were a separate nation. Muslims of this played a very important role in advocating this theory. A few nationalist Muslims protested against it. They combined with the Hindus because both were perturbed at the advocacy of such a theory and raise their voice. But my Muslim League brothers had made a strong plea for for separation. They said they were not satisfied with the separate electorates and safeguard of minority rights. They wanted separation and the establishment of a separate state. Throughout the length and breadth of India, the Muslim leaguers spread the doctrine of separation. Muslim youth mostly came under their influence. They accepted it as the whole truth, but it was not consequently. A wall was raised between them and those who were in the Congress. In Calcutta on August 15, the Direct Action Movement was launched by them to give a direct blow to those who still did not believe in the two-nation theory. We then thought, if there was to be a division of the country, let it be so. Let them manage their own affairs, and we will manage our own. After all, we had to drive out a foreign power. We were then facing the problem of getting rid of an alien ruler. So we accepted the division of the country and thought we would consider the partition question later. I will be glad if the Muslim leaguers can make Pakistan a heaven. I'll be happy if Pakistan becomes strong, happy, and prosperous. But we did not think that even after separation, we would not have breathing time. It is said today that the plans for sabotaging Pakistan are being hatched in Hindustan. But I assure you, all that plan for destroying Pakistan is not being hatched in Hindustan. If it is being hatched, it is being done in Pakistan. It is the situation in Pakistan that will ruin Pakistan. Sometimes they accuse the Hindus, the Sikhs, the central government of creating troubles. But I tell you that if Pakistan falls, it will fall not on account of us, but on account of its own enemies within. The Muslim leaguers call me their greatest enemy. Formerly, they used to call Mahatma Gandhi as enemy number one. Now they think Gandhiji is their friend and have constituted me in his place. But I too speak the truth. They believe that if they got Pakistan, they would ensure full protection for the Muslims. But I have never looked at Muslims living in Hindustan. Have they ever sympathized with them? When freedom was won, there came the Punjab massacre, which lowered our prestige. Then came the Junagadh issue, followed by the Kashmir problem. We raised this question with Pakistan. They replied, "We are not concerned." It was the Azad government Dal in Kashmir and the Kashmir Muslims who were responsible for aggression. But it is no secret that the frontier tribesmen are receiving rations, war material, motor trucks, and petrol. As a last resort, the idea, when it was not working, the India government referred the Kashmir issue to the UNO. Muhammad Zafarullah Khan asks why we went out to wash the dirty linen. Are they not satisfied with washing their dirt in the Punjab in the last 4 months? It's a deliberate falsehood. I want to ask the Indian Muslims only one question. in the recent All India Muslim Conference, why did you not open your mouth on Kashmir? Why did you not condemn the action of Pakistan? These things create doubt in the minds of the people. So I want to say a word as a friend of Muslims, and it is the duty of a good friend to speak frankly. It is your duty now to sail in the same boat and sink or swim together. I want to tell you very clearly that you cannot ride on two horses. You have to select one horse, whichever you like best. It's not possible ever to ride two horses. In the Constituent Assembly, one of the Lucknow Muslim leaders pleaded for separate electorates and reservation of the seats. I had to open my mouth and say that he could not have it both ways. Now he is in Pakistan. Those who want to go to Pakistan can go there and live in peace. Let us live in peace to work for ourselves. The Muslim League government in Pakistan declared that they would make suitable arrangements for the minorities living there. But ask the Singh Hindu refugees today, the Sindhis, they say that it is impossible to remain there. Pakistan is drifting towards lawlessness. There are about 8 to 10 lakhs of Hindus who want to come out of Pakistan. Some say 8 to 10 lakhs of Muslims should be driven out of Hindustan, but this is not a sound policy. Let them leave Pakistan alone to pursue their policy. We are not at all disturbed. If they want to fight, we are 34 crores here. We have also men, material and resources. Pakistan is a baby of yesterday. But it is not wise to mete out the same treatment to the Muslims as the Hindus are receiving there. I understand there is an urge for military training amongst the youth. Military training is good, and there is a great need of it. You should now discard fighting with lathis, daggers and brickbats. I appeal to the young men of India to unify India on all sides. Do not forget that India was lost on account of foolishness. That foolishness should never be repeated in future. But unfortunately, I find same foolishness prevailing everywhere. If the state's problem had not been handled properly, there would have been a Rajasthan, the screen of a political department between us and the states have been withdrawn. I contacted Rajas of various states as soon as Paramount C was over. Most of them are real patriots. I explained to them the present political situation and apprised them of the situation in Pakistan. I also stressed the point that India was lost on account of internal feuds. They have agreed with me, and I am happy that they have understood me and my point. There are many who criticize us and complain. This has not been done. That has not been done. I have all along told them, and still I say, let us have some time, some breathing time, and then see what we have done and what we are doing. To criticize, I want to say that since August 15, when we took charge, we have done an enormous amount of work. What about the partition work? The smashing of the steel frame of bureaucracy, the division of assets and liabilities, and the refugee problem. We called a meeting of the Constituent Assembly and settled with the states. I assure you that if so much burden had fallen on all of a sudden on any government's shoulder, it would have crashed. But we did not fail. As a matter of fact, the manner in which we have discharged our onerous duties has raised our prestige in the world. Now, two things are needed for reconstruction of India's strong central government and a formidable army. By army, I mean all the branches, naval, air, and land forces. If the relation between Pakistan and Hindustan continues as present, the consequences cannot be foreseen. I am not hiding anything, but I am telling bare facts. I would not like anybody to throw dust into our eyes. I appeal to the Hindu Mahasabhas to join Congress. No good will be served by remaining aloof. If you think that you are the only custodians of Hinduism, you are mistaken. Hinduism preaches a broader outlook on life. This is much more than tolerance in Hinduism than it is interpreted. I appeal to the RSS to use their wisdom and work judiciously. I want them not to be rash and tactless. Do not be aggressive. Those who are disloyal will have to go to Pakistan. Those who are still riding on two horses will have to quit Hindustan. In the Congress, those who are in power feel that by a virtue of authority, they will be able to crush the RSS. By danda, you cannot suppress an organization. Moreover, danda is meant for the thieves and dakus. Using the danda will not help much. After all, RSS men are not thieves and dacoits. They are patriots. They love their country. Only their trend of thought is diverted. They are to be won over by congressmen with love. I appeal to the labor leaders not to foment strikes and create disturbances. There is no alien power now. It is easy to approach it now. Why should labor leaders not come straight to us and tell about the grievances of the labor? The Trade Union Congress is working under the influence of communists. The day of strike and Hartal are gone. They were needed when we were fighting against a foreign power. Those tactics must cease now. Give us time at least. Let us have 3 to 4 years of truce and see what we do. For a strong army, industries for production of necessary material are needed. And if there is labor unrest, a strong and formidable army cannot be built up. At the last industrial conference, like the labor leaders agreed with us, but still was a day of strike in Bombay. If you all proceed on these lines, India will meet a disastrous end. Unless you produce more, how can you share the profits? India is not an industrialized country. She is to be industrialized first. this sort of foolishness will only put obstacles in the way of the country. Therefore, I tell all people who are bent on doing strikes and create other disturbances because somehow they are unhappy, to just give us time to breathe. And I tell all those who try to ride two horses that it is not possible. If you are not happy here, you can go to Pakistan. This is all that I have to say now. Thank you.